Greetings everybody, my name is Alex and welcome to the Making of Crims. I've done commentary for about 7 years now and I've discovered many different ways to record on different platforms. So what we're gonna do today is to go through all these types of recordings, and we're gonna have a table of contents here as you can see on the screen, so you can just click on the chapter that you're most interested in. And there will also be links in the description below, so you can click on that. So we're gonna head into the second chapter now, which is recording. All right, so the recording part is obviously the most important. And we're gonna branch off into different sections as you can see here. We're gonna first talk about the PC recordings, and then we're gonna go into console recordings. And then the console recording, we're gonna go into the three different types of cables I use, which is HDMI, component, and then lastly, composite. And then the third step is going to be microphones, how you record your voice. So when it comes to PC recording, it's really simple compared to recording on consoles. All you do is get a program, maybe like Fraps, I've used that a lot, it works great. Or right now I'm using the GeForce Experience and I can just press record whenever I want and records everything on the screen and every audio. So for example, let's bring up Undertale here. And so when we have Fraps, you see this frame rate counter up to the left corner. So all we do is press record, and now it records the game footage with the audio perfectly in sync in compressed great quality. It's very simple, and then you just sync up your commentary with it. It works great. Now I'll play this game. So when it comes to recording games on a console, you obviously need a capture card. I've used this one, the Blackmagic Intensity Shuttle, for about 3.5 years. It works great. And then I'm using the Dazzle over here for retro games, because this one does not take the video signal from retro consoles, such as the Super Nintendo or the N64, for example. This capture card, it has HDMI in, and then component in, S-Video in, composite in, and then of course left, right, RCA in. And then it has every single of those out as well. So it's a wonderful capture card, it works wonders, and it goes into my PC over there. So, let's first look at how we record games with HDMI. So here we have Yoshi's Woolly World, and it is on the Wii U. So we see here we have the Wii U, and the Wii U has HDMI out. So that cord goes into, of course, the capture card right there. And then the capture card goes into the PC, and so it records here on a program called Media Express. So I can just press record here. You can see the audio and the game capture. And then we have the HDMI out into the TV so we can see and we can play the game at the same time. Some people sit at their computer while recording. I like to do it just like the Angry Video Game Nerd or James Rolf. He wants to sit in a couch and play the game like you did back in the day. You sit in the couch like this and you play the game, and then you have the microphone like that recording you. And that's like a classic way, and that's how I like to do it. It feels a lot better to sit on a couch than on a computer chair and like hunched over like that. I don't like it. Now there's something very important to think about when it comes to recording consoles, is that some games run at 60 FPS and some games run at 30. And how you know that is not simple. You need to figure it out, you need to see it for yourself. I've noticed and I've seen that Yoshi's Woolly World runs in 60 FPS. So what we do then is that on this program, we have to go into Edit, Preferences, and then you can choose here what quality you have. Project Video Format. So right now we're going with 720 at 59.94. It's not 60 FPS, it's actually this one. Now you might be asking yourself, why aren't you using, for example, 1080 at this? This capture card does not allow recording of 1080p at 60 FPS. So it's not the best capture card in the world, but it works for me, and 720 at 60 is more than enough. So for games like Woolly World, we want it to be 720 at 59.94. And then we just press record like this. It now captures. So we move around and it goes in 60 FPS. Wonderful. But then how do you do when you have a game that doesn't run in 60 FPS? What you can do is record it at 60 and then just export it at 30. It doesn't really matter, you can do that. But instead, what you can do is go for 1080 at 30 FPS. So for a game like, let's say, Pikmin 3. Pikmin 3 does not run in 60 FPS, it runs in 30. But what we can do then is record the game at 1080 30. So we just pop the game in, we change the video settings on the Wii U, and then we go into preferences again, and we choose 1080p at, for example, this one. It doesn't usually work, so what we will have to do is go with the 1080i at 60 FPS, or yeah, 59.94, and then deinterlace it to 30 full frames. What we get then is 1080p at 29.97 FPS. This one should work right away, just do this, but this capture card doesn't. So we will have to go with 1080i at 59.94 and then deinterlace it so it goes into 1080p at 29.97. It may sound confusing, and believe me, it is in the beginning, but after a while you get used to it, you know how to do it. So that's how it works. That's why PC recording is much simpler. But hey, if you want to do it on a console, this is how you do it. Alright, so now we are recording a game which runs at 30 FPS. So I changed the video settings on the Wii U to run at 1080i, just because this capture card can take 1080p at 60 FPS. So it is at 1080i. And then in this program, we go into Edit, Preferences, and then we choose 1080i at 59.94. Press OK, and then we can just click record on that. So now we're recording it in 1080i at 59.97. So check in later for the deinterlacing part and how we make this into 1080p at 29.97 FPS. So yeah, this game, among others, runs at 30, so there's no point to record it in, you know, 60 FPS. So instead of 720 at 60, we get 1080 at 30. Once again, I hope it isn't too confusing, but hey, that's how it is. So that's how we record that. It works great, and we're gonna deinterlace this later. But now, let's go into how we record with the component cables. Okay, so now we are recording from the Wii, which has component cables, which goes into the capture card right here. These five gray cables. So that goes into, of course, the PC. And in the PC, we then have to choose, depending on the game and which hertz you play in, but if you live in the USA and use NTSC, that's what you use. So you press NTSC, which is interlaced. And then we have the game right here. This is Eternal Darkness Sanity's Requiem. Now, here's the thing. I live in Europe, so we have PAL for many different games. And some games come with 60 Hz option, so we play in the same frame rate as in, you know, the USA, which uses NTSC. And this game thankfully does that. So we are playing on the Wii, a GameCube game, and it is in 60 Hz interlaced, and it goes in here and we can record like that. Now, the other thing is that some games, just like the Wii U, some games run at 60 and some games run at 30. So this particular game runs in 60. So we're gonna record it interlaced. It doesn't matter if it's 30 or 60. We just record it just like that. So that's recording. And as we run around, you can probably see that this game flows very nicely. So this game is in 60 FPS, but it's interlaced. So once again, check into the deinterlacing chapter, how we make this into 480p, 60 FPS, or 59.94, but it's easier to say 60. So this game uses 60 FPS, and we're recording it with just NTSC standard interlaced, and then we're gonna deinterlace it later on. Now let's take a look at the game that doesn't run in 60 and how we do with that. So now we're recording Resident Evil Remake for the GameCube. Now here in the PAL region, we do have an option to play this game in NTSC 60Hz, so that's what we're going with. So once again, it goes from the Wii, goes into, yeah, component in there. And then same thing as with Eternal Darkness, we're recording at the NTSC, even though it's a 30 FPS game. It doesn't matter. So we're recording it like this. We can press here. So now we're recording it 480i, so interlaced. And so when we go around in this game, we notice that it's not as fluent as Eternal Darkness because it runs in 30 FPS. And so there is a different way to deinterlace this later. So you check on that in that chapter, and you will see for yourself. I would also like to point out that some games on the PlayStation, for example Shadow of the Colossus, has an option to play it in NTSC Progressive, or just Progressive Scan. And so that works as well with this capture card. So you go in here, and instead of NTSC, you choose NTSC Progressive. So, but only a few games have that in the PAL region. Shadow of the Colossus has it, Haunting Grounds, for example. I do believe that in USA, a lot of GameCube games have the option for Progressive Scan, and also the component out on the GameCube. So that's the same deal there, component out, if it is Progressive Scan, you just choose NTSC Progressive in the menu, and there off you go. It's progressive, so you don't need to deinterlace it. It's perfect. But here in the PAL region, in Europe, we don't have that option for many games. So we're gonna go with the example of Resident Evil Remake and Eternal Darkness, where it's interlaced in 60Hz. So we're gonna deinterlace that later on. Now we're gonna try to record something on the Super Nintendo. So let's take Secret of Evermore, for example. So what I use for recording these types of consoles, like the N64, is that I use... It's kind of hard to see here, but I use one of these SCART cables that has the AV out. So that's composite yellow, white, or black in this case, and red. The red one is right audio, the black one is left audio, you know, in stereo, and this one is the yellow connector. It is composite video. And so this cable goes into this TV right here with the SCART. Now SCART is something we have in Europe in the PAL region. I don't think USA has that so much, but that's what I use. If you don't have that, you can use the regular composite cables. You see these three right here. These three into the Dazzle right away. But then you don't have any signal to your TV, for example, if you want to do that. So you either get some splitters. So you know, it splits the signal, it goes into the capture card, but also the TV at the same time. Or you can play on the monitor on a preview window, which I did for a time, and that really sucks. But this works great, have the SCART with AV out, and the AV out goes into this capture card, the Dazzle, and then the SCART goes into the TV. So that works great. Now, the problem is that with this TV, it doesn't take retro signals with SCART. So what we get is this very dark... it's almost impossible to see anything. It looks like crap. Let's see here. External. See if we get anything. I think it's going to be too dark to see anything at all. Yeah, so this TV doesn't work. You see, we got some text there. And then we got the menu, probably. So yeah, we're derailing here. This is just a problem with this particular TV. It doesn't work at all. So I usually have to go with, you know, right into the TV or right into the Dazzle capture card and then play off this preview window. But let's take a look at how you record retro games. You don't use the Media Express for this one because this capture card cannot take the retro signals, as I said before. So we're gonna use another program called Virtual Dub. Let's see if we can focus, there we go. So we just go into File, Capture AVI, and then we should see the game. Here we go. So here we have Secret of Evermore. Let's take the controller here. Let's select the file, if we can. Let's see. Here we go. So here we go. Here we are. We can play the game off the preview. It works, but it's not, you know, optimal. But you see, here's the audio signal. Here's the game. So what we do now, since I live in Europe, I use the PAL code. The Super Nintendo does not include, you know, NTSC options, so we will have to record this in the PAL, which is 50 Hz or 25 FPS. But in any case, the difference isn't that big in how you record it. So what we do is go into Capture Filter, and then you choose the corresponding standard. We're using PAL now, but if you live in, you know, USA and you play on a USA Super Nintendo, you choose NTSC instead. And then you need to make sure that the custom format is set to the appropriate resolution, or else nothing will show up. For example, if I take this resolution and I press OK, nothing is going to show up at all. So the problem is that the resolution is wrong. With the PAL code, you use 720 at 576 pixels. That's the PAL resolution. The NTSC or USA resolution is 480. So you just change that, but see, now it works. Works just fine. We have the audio. We can select audio capture. It's the Dazzle capture device. And then we just press record, and we will record it in 576i interlaced. And we're gonna deinterlace that later. But for now, let's go ahead and capture video. We're just gonna set capture file name to SNES test. Let's see that. Capture video and press OK. There we go. Now we're recording the game. Let's go around a little bit so we can see the interlacing in action later on. But this will be just fine. Now, when it comes to microphones and recording your commentary, there are many different ways and different microphones you can use. I've recently started using this one, which is the SM57 Shure dynamic microphone with a pop filter to boot, and with this microphone stand made in Germany. I normally use this microphone for miking up this guitar amplifier, but it also works great for commentary, and since it is dynamic, it doesn't pick up much noise and room reverb. So I'm very happy with it and it sounds great. But for the most of crims, like 80%, no, even more, 90% of everything I've ever done commentary with is with this one, a condenser microphone. I now forgot the name of it, it's quite complex, but it's a condenser microphone for about $200, I think. It's very good, but in a room like this, where it's kind of big and there's a lot of room reverb sometimes, I don't like this microphone because condenser microphones are very sensitive. They pick up everything, including the family upstairs who, you know, walk about. You can probably hear them sometimes. So with a condenser microphone, you don't want that in a noisy environment or a room full of reverb. So that's why when I'm living here, I'm using this one, a dynamic microphone, which doesn't pick up as much. It isn't as sensitive, but then I can have it closer to my mouth. And so we get this very consistent good sound and not much reverb and stomping shit from upstairs. So whatever works for you is, you know, just how it is at home for you. Condenser microphones sound better. They are, you know, more clear. Very good with the high frequencies, you know, the S sounds, those. Very clear with that. But this one, it's very good, but isn't as clear in tone. So it's just what you're going after. Creams is kind of rough with, you know, his commentaries, so a rough microphone just works fine. Or if you want, you can just go with a standard headset, you know, very standard microphone. I started out making commentary using a normal table microphone for like $10. That's my first commentary was made with that. So just whatever your budget is and whatever you want it to be, then, you know, there are many different ways to do it. But the most important thing is that you like how it sounds. I've gone between this one and this one a lot. But, you know, recently I'm using this one much more because of my situation. So they are, you know, real microphones, so to speak. So they use XLR cables, which goes into a mixer board. So this is a very cheap, basic mixer board called the Scenix 302 USB. So it has one XLR input right here, and then a regular, adjust the volume. So, and that goes into the PC. Right there. I have two of those for some stupid reason. So that's what you need if you're gonna use real microphones. But if you just have a headset, just plug it into your PC and use a program like Audacity to record it. A quick note about recording, you know, retro games. Most of the time I don't record using the RCA input on the capture card. Instead, I take these two, the red and white, or black and red, and those goes into here. And so I record the game audio separately, because I've had some troubles with audio sync. So most of the time I go with directly into one of those. So one is for recording the commentary, and one is for recording the game audio. I've done that for a long time, but recently I started just going straight into the capture card. And that works, but you have more freedom if you record separately, and it works better with sync. But whatever works for you, just try. I've tried many different ways. Most people don't have two mixer boards like I do, so just go straight into the capture card, works great. The same thing as I do with the Blackmagic. So microphones, just try and see what works for you and what your budget is. And let's go to the next step. So now let's go into deinterlacing. So first let's talk about what that is. First off, we have interlaced footage and we have progressive footage. Today we see progressive, that's the standard. You see 720p and 1080p. And progressive is basically full frames. For example, 60 full frames per second. There's no bullshitting around, every single frame is its own picture. But when it comes to interlacing, that's an old standard, which basically means fields swapping up and down in a corresponding hertz. For example, in the USA, they had 60 hertz. So it's basically the fields move 60 times per second, creating 30 full frames per second. So, yeah, a 60 hertz video game could result in 30 full frames per second. It's kind of confusing. You can look up more if you want to, just Google interlacing and progressive and look into that. But what we're gonna talk about is how we deinterlace it, make it into progressive. Because if you watch interlaced footage, which you get from these old consoles, on a progressive monitor, you get this kind of weird ghosting effect. I'm gonna show an example right here. So when we pause this this footage right here, you see that like two fields are, you know, kind of at the same time. So it gives this weird ghosting effect. It's not good, we don't want that. So what we're gonna do is make it look like this, a full frame, so to speak. So we're gonna deinterlace it. So first off, we're gonna go into how we deinterlace different platforms. The first one is going to be HDMI when we record in 1080i, so we can, you know, make that progressive instead. And then we're gonna talk about component, which some games run at 60 frames per second, and some games only run at 30. It varies on the different types of games. I'm gonna show you the examples, but I'm gonna show you how to deinterlace them properly to their corresponding frame rate. So here we have all the files we have recorded from the consoles. We're gonna start off with the HDMI at 1080i, which is the Pikmin 3 video, and we're gonna make it into 1080p at 29.97 frames per second, because this game doesn't run in 60. So we're gonna open up a program called Virtual Dub, and we're just gonna drag it in here. Now, what we're gonna see here is the raw footage. This is how it's going to be unedited. Now, if we shrink that in size, we can now see two screens. Let's shrink these two. So this is the raw footage, and this is how it will be after we're done. We're gonna just decrease this one so it's barely visible. We could actually go with this. Let's see, 75%, and just shrink it like that. Because the important part here is to see the interlacing. So we're gonna scroll forward. I did a new recording just to get some better examples at the interlacing. So let's go ahead and take a look at the screen over here where we changed the camera very drastically. So let's see. Yeah, I think this should do. So you see here, we have two of them, two fields. So what we want to do is to get rid of that. So let's take up this one and have it over there so you can see it. And this is how we're going to fix it. So we're going to go into Video, Filters. We're going to click Add. And then we're going to select deinterlace. There's many different plugins you can use, but we're going to use the default deinterlace for this particular video. So, when we're going from a 60 FPS down to 30, and we want to keep the full resolution, also known as, you know, go from 1080i to 1080p, but at 30 FPS instead of 60, which this game runs in. So we're gonna use a JDiff algorithm, and we're gonna keep the top field and interpolate or discard the bottom field. It is interpolate when it goes with JDiff. We're not gonna discard the bottom field. If we would have discarded it, we would have ended up with a 540 pixels in height. So that would be half of 1080. And that's not what we want. We want the full resolution here. So we're gonna click OK and click OK again. And now you can see we have fixed it. We went from this to stands and all this interlace mice teeth, some people like to call them, to this, you know, not that. But the cool thing about JDiff is that we get the full resolution in quiet areas. Now, what I mean by quiet areas is places like this. Look at the left text. It never changes, you know, it's a quiet area of the screen. This doesn't change, but the background on this changes. So these parts, the quiet areas, will always have their full resolution, while these parts that move fast will sadly only have half in height for that period when it's moving. For example, here's a very good example. So when the left text goes down, you can see that we don't have the full resolution of it. But as soon as it stands still, there, we get the full resolution. Let's go back again to see. It goes down. We have half the height resolution, 540. And once it goes to another frame where it stands still, boom, we get the full resolution of it. So this is 1080p, the quiet areas. I hope it isn't too confusing. Another example would be if we used some other type of deinterlace, for example, ELA. Now look at the left text. Boom, we lost half the resolution in height for everything. Everything on the screen loses half of its value in height. But with JDiff, it works it around so the quiet areas get the full resolution, and that's what we want. So here we have a very good comparison. We went from this to this. So that's how you deinterlace 1080i from 60 FPS to 1080p at 30 FPS. So let's take a look at the component recordings from the GameCube. First off, we have Eternal Darkness, which is a 60 FPS game, and then we have Resident Evil Remake, which is a 30 FPS game. But both are in the NTSC 60Hz 480i resolution. They're both interlaced at the same rate, everything, but the games vary how they use these fields. So first, we're gonna take a look at Eternal Darkness. And we're gonna see here if we go back to 100% on both of these. We're gonna take away the effects, so now it's just neutral. Let's see here. There we go. So let's go to an area where it is interlaced. For example, here would be very good. Now you can definitely see Alex's sword and her hair and everything. We have these mice teeth again. So we're gonna fix that in another way this time. It's still a deinterlacing mode, but we're not gonna use this one. We're gonna use something called Bob Doubler. Now it upsamples an interlaced video to double frame rate. So the video file, if we take a look at it, is actually at 30 FPS or 29.97. But we have two fields for every frame, making up 59.94 fields per second. So we're gonna upsample it so we get every field in its on its own. So we have a preview here. Now if we deinterlace using the Bob method, you see here we have every single field in its own frame. So now we got 59.97 frames, but every frame in height is only half the resolution. It's only 240 pixels in height and upstretched to 480. But we get no interlaced lines. We get every single frame of Alex. We get this very smooth movement and it looks great. But as we did with Pikmin 3, we want the quiet areas to be in its full resolution. So what we do then is select something called Adaptive ELA. Now what this will do is that the quiet areas will have its full resolution, 480 pixels in height, while the other areas that are not quiet, you know, moving, will be in half the resolution. So it's going to be like a mix. Some the quiet areas are going to be 480 and the moving areas are going to be 240. I think it's a very good way to do it, because like in menus and texts you get the full resolution of it and it looks great. But it really depends on the game. If it's a game like F-Zero GX where there is a lot of movement on the entire screen, I would recommend going with the Bob one instead. As you can see, what happens with this ELA adaptive is that we sometimes get these artifacts. You see these? It's very hard to see in a full motion video. Maybe, it kind of depends. So, as I said, it varies depending on the type of game. If you don't want these types of artifacts, it's, you know, it's kind of hard to see. I don't think most people will notice them. But, for example, this one was very obvious. Now, it all depends on you. So if you don't want that, you can just go ahead and use a Bob Doubler and use a normal Bob instead. And boom, you don't get any artifacts. But, you know, the quiet areas will also have the resolution cut off. There are some other tools you can use. You can also use an area-based deinterlace. And you can set it, you know, however it is, you know, for the game. Now we're gonna click this Show Deinterlaced Areas Only. This is going to show us what it deinterlaces. So the gray areas are the quiet areas, so to speak. And this is what it's getting deinterlaced. So if we take away this box, now we're gonna see... Yeah, it doesn't look so good. You need to, you know, change the settings so it works much better. But still, I would suggest in a fast-moving game, use the... the normal Bob. And in a, you know, non-fast moving game, which runs at 60 FPS, use the adaptive ELA. It all depends on the game. But yeah, that's the basic deal of how you deinterlace. So, for example, with this game, I would go with Bob like that, and you will not get any interlaced lines whatsoever. And let's see here again. Yeah, you see. Clean and nice. That's how we like it. Now let's take a look at the other game we recorded on the GameCube, which was Resident Evil Remake. Now, as I said, this game runs in 30 FPS. It doesn't use every field to create its own image. So instead, we only get 30 frames per second, but it is interlaced. So let's take a very good example here at, you know, with Chris's gun. If we zoom that in, you can see we have two fields of his gun, like that. So what we want to do with this type of game is very similar to Pikmin 3, where we want to go from 60 hertz to 30 FPS. So
we're gonna go into add, deinterlace and use JDiff once again. And boom, if we go to this one, how it's going to look afterwards, we don't get the interlaced lines. But however, we do get the full resolution, the full 480 pixels in height on the quiet areas. And the menu is a very good example of that. But also we don't get, for example, on the left side now, once we change the screen here, we're going to have a frame with two fields with two different screens. It looks ridiculous. So instead we get this. And then this game is a very good game to use JDiff on, because Resident Evil uses a lot of quiet areas. You see, all this area around here is totally quiet. It doesn't move at all. Only Chris is moving. So we will get the full resolution of everything except for Chris and other moving objects when it's only moving. But then, you know, this game is just perfect for this type. There's a lot of quiet areas, so I would highly recommend going with JDiff here. Let's take a better example in the menu here. So let's see, we have this one up here. Now look at, for example, the fine text here. If we use another one, for example, Bob, and we double the frame rate to 60, we will get this type, where it, you know, switches between the fields all the time. It will not look good. And since the game, you know, only is 30 FPS in gameplay, it's just going to show the same frame twice, but with two different fields. It's not very good at all. If we use the ELA and, you know, keep the top and interpolate the bottom, you see here, look at the fine text. If we enhance that, we can do it like that. You see, we can almost not even read. We can almost not see the E. But if we use, JDiff instead, look how clear it gets, because right now we're only using 240 pixels in height, but once we use JDiff, we're gonna get the full 480, that's double the resolution height. It's much better, and it works perfect for quiet areas. For example, look now, in the beginning when it moves, we only get half of the resolution on the moving areas, but once it stands still, boom, we get the full resolution. And as I said, this game has a lot of quiet areas on the screen, so this is just perfect. So that's how you do it with, 30 FPS games. So finally, let's take a look at the composite recording of our Super Nintendo, which was Secret of Evermore. Now this game is very similar to Eternal Darkness, where every field is its own frame. A very good example of this is in the menu here. When this spirals into the middle, we see two fields for every frame. So what we want to do, just like with Eternal Darkness, we want every field to get its own frame. Now, the biggest difference here is that Eternal Darkness and those types of games run at 480 pixels. But these old games, retro, Super Nintendo, NES, and Nintendo 64, they are in 240 pixels resolution. So that means that every field is its full resolution. The game isn't in 480. So what you can do is basically the same thing. Actually, you don't have to think too much. You can use the Bob doubler and adapt the VLA. Scratch that. We want to use the deinterlace and then duplicate fields and double the frame rate. So what we're gonna get now is every single field as its own 240 frame. No deinterlacing, everything looks as exactly how it should do, and this is just perfect. If you would have used this mode, the duplicate fields in Eternal Darkness, you would get this jumping up and down all the time, very similar to how certain CRT TVs uses 480i on the CRT monitor. It will jump up and down very much. I have that experience with my CRT TV. But this game, which is in 240 pixels in height, we don't get that jumping. Instead, we get it perfectly like this. And a good example of what I'm meaning here is that if you use, for example, Bob, and like this, we will get this jumping up and down. You see that? If we kind of press play, it jumps up and down all the time. very similar to how CRT monitor makes it. Now it is in the wrong order. It depends on the game. We're gonna use top field first instead, and now it's going to be, you know, every field for itself, but it's going to jump up and down all the time, every single frame. So that's not what we want. It will not look good at all. You could also use the adaptive ELA, which will, you know, make it not do that. But you will only get half of the resolution of the moving parts once again. For example, look at the flash text here, how much it changes before it actually stays in its full resolution. You see, we have the two fields and then it goes into full resolution. It's not good. So instead, let's go with duplicate fields like that. And look now, we will get the full resolution right away. No flashing, no jumping, nothing. The full resolution everywhere. That's perfect. Exactly how we want it. So now I'm going to show you some other tools we can use in Virtual Dub to make it even better. For example, you can see the black bars surrounding the video. And also, when you record on console, you have the have a risk to get the wrong aspect ratio. And right now, this is not the correct one. When you record HDMI, for example on a Wii U or Xbox 360, you will get the correct aspect ratio and you will not get any black borders around. So that's good. But with retro games and GameCube, PlayStation 2 and so on, you will get these black borders around and often you will get the wrong aspect ratio. So what we do to fix that is, once again, we're gonna deinterlace it, which we have here with the JDiff algorithm. And now we're going to click add. We're going to add a null transform. It does nothing, typically used as a placeholder for cropping. So we're gonna select the cropping tool here. I'm gonna bring up this menu. We're gonna make it bigger so we can see. So now we're just basically going to take away the blackness on, you know, all around the video. And after that, we're gonna make it into the right aspect ratio. You can see the new resolution up here to the left as I changed this. But so we now end up with 640 pixels and 448. The correct aspect ratio should, you know, in a 4x3 non-widescreen, should be 640 at 480. But as you can see, it is not. If we press OK now, we will see the corners are gone. Now we only have the game and nothing else. But it is not in the correct aspect ratio. You could click here and select 4x3 and boom, it will change it. Now it is the correct one, but it will not render that way. This is how it actually will look. So we need to fix it here instead by going down here and selecting resize. Now here we have many different options. We're gonna go into filter mode and change it to A equals 1 to get a very get a better resize quality. We're gonna click disable and absolute pixels here so we can change it however we want. And if it's going to be a 4x3 in 480, we're just gonna change this one to 480. So now we have 640 at 480, which is a standard 4x3 resolution. We press OK and boom, there we go. The correct aspect ratio, it's deinterlaced, and also no black bars around it. Now, when it comes to YouTube and uploading there, you get better quality if you upload an HD video, for example a 720p video. You will get better audio quality and also better video compressing from YouTube. So what I usually do is to increase this, to upscale it, in other words, to 960 at 720. So it's still going to be a 4x3, but we upscale it to HD. So now it's even bigger and it will result in better looking video. So let's take an example here and I'm gonna show exactly what we've done. So we went from this having two fields interlaced with black bars around it and the wrong aspect ratio to this one. Upscaled to HD, cropping, there is no black bars around it, there are no interlaced shits, it all is exactly how it should be. So we see there's a big difference in how you can do it. There are some other effects you can use, I wouldn't recommend it. I want to keep it as close to the originals as possible. This is just fixing problems well, this other things are like changing things, and I don't want to change anything. I only want to fix the problems. So here we go, that we have that. Now we can just save this as an AVI, and then we can edit it. So now when I've shown you everything we can do in Virtual Dub, let's take a look at how a full session is recorded.
All right, so what I want to do now is to take you through an entire process of recording a Crims session, and then we can record it together in Premiere Pro. So first off, as we can see here on the game, please excuse the camera angle, but we have Resident Evil Remake here, for example. It's plugged in, the game works, it's into the capture card, and we can see it way over there on the PC screen. And we have the microphone over here, and the controller. So when all that is up and we have the game on the screen there, what I do is that I go to the PC over here. Please excuse audio quality. I make sure that it is on NTSC, that all this set, all the settings are right. And then I go into Audacity to first off start the commentary recording from the microphone. So I make sure that I have the right microphone selected. And then I just press record. So now I'm recording the audio from that microphone. I'm gonna make it so you can hear me from that one instead, so you don't have to hear this room. So we're gonna make a quick sync like that. And so now the commentary has been recorded. Now we go into Media Express. And what I do here is that I say now at the same time as I start the video recording. That makes it easier to sync up later. So I'm gonna press capture now. There we go. So now we're recording the game and the commentary. Now another way to sync it up.
Now you can hear me over here instead. Hope that's better. So, I have the controller in my hand. So, in order to be sure that I have synced up my commentary with the video recording, it depends on the game really, but in this case, Resident Evil is very easy to sync up audio. I just go ahead and go into audio setup, disable the music, so it's only sound left, press OK. Then we go into the options, I mean the menu, inventory. And then I just say test or something else at the same time as I move the cursor. So I can do like test, test. And if you record the game audio separately, this is also a very good way to sync up the game audio to the game video recording. Just by doing this. This is how I did it back with Resident Evil 2. But now we're recording the game audio at the same time, so we don't even need to sync up that. But if you need to sync up, that's what you do. But yeah, in the end, when we record it and edit, we want to be able to just do tests, and everything is in sync. The game audio with the game footage, and our commentary with the game. So I just go around like, yeah, fucking spiders, holy shit, let's go. We're gonna go through here, and like, yeah, I just start whenever I feel like it. It doesn't matter when you start, like, let's do. Greetings everybody, my name is Crims and welcome back to some more Resident Evil Remake. We have some bloody naked zombies here, there's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance with them. And they puke, of course, and then we shoot their dick off if we can. No we couldn't, he doesn't really care. Let's go ahead and shoot off his knees instead. Boom! And his friend also wants something, so we're gonna invite him. And there we go. His head blew off. Oh, nice. Let's continue. This door, it's rusted shut. Okay. So, yeah. Basically, that's how we do. We just record. And there you go. So, now we can go into the video editing process chapter. And we can go into how we edit the video and how we edit the audio. And level out the audio balance and all that shit. So now we're gonna go into video editing. Now, this varies very much from person to person, how much you've learned, how much, which program you use, and all these sorts of things. I've used Adobe Premiere Pro for a long time, and I'm gonna continue using it because it just works so well for me. And then the projects themselves,
vary depending on which platform you have recorded on. So we're gonna go through that right now.
Alright, so now when everything is recorded and everything is deinterlaced, we have our files here. Here's the commentary test I just did with the camera. And here is the small session we just did. And it is dubbed, you know, virtual dub, deinterlaced. So we're gonna open up Adobe Premiere Pro CS6 and open up a new project. And we're gonna name it Remake Test. And then I already have a preset for it, but we go into settings. Editing mode should be on custom. Time base for this game, you know, it differs, but this game is in 29.97, so we choose that. I did go with the upscale to 720, so we're gonna go with 960 to 720 in this pixel aspect ratio, square pixels, and we get the 4x3, you know, non-widescreen. And then fields, we're gonna have no fields, we're gonna have progressive because we deinterlaced it. And then sample rate, usually you record with 48kHz, I always do that, so we're gonna go with this. Make sure it's the same that you recorded with. And then we press OK, and we open up the project here. So, we're gonna drag in the remake dubbed file, and also the commentary. So these are the two key, you know, files. We have the game footage, the game audio, and my commentary. You know, that's the gist of it, you know. I don't do face cam, so I'm not gonna go how you do that, but it's pretty simple, you can figure it out. We're gonna make sure that this... these are the same frame rate, and also the same, hertz in audio. So first thing first, we're gonna drag in the commentary. And we can make that bigger. So now it's going to generate peak files for these two. It can take a little while depending on how long the session was, but it's much easier once you have it, because you can see the audio waves, or the audio signal, much clearer. So I'm gonna cut to that. Alright, so they're finished, and now we can see the audio signal here, and we can just take a listen. I just go around like, yeah, fucking spiders, holy... You see, it sounds great, and it works. So we have the commentary there, we're gonna change it down to the second track, because the first track is going to be the game audio and game footage. So we're gonna scroll down a bit, let's see if we can... There we go, so we see all three tracks at the same time. So first thing we're gonna listen to when I say now. So let's listen.
I'm gonna make it so you can hear me from that one. It says you don't have to hear this room. We're gonna make a quick sync. That.
Let's see, when do I start the video recording?
I'm gonna press capture now.
There we go. So we can just move it there, around there. And then we use the testing part to sync it up much easier. So let's see how it sounds.
There we go. So now we're recording.
Yeah, as you can hear, the game audio is way too loud compared to the commentary. But that's also because we are so far away from it. So now let's listen to, you know, when we're close to the microphone. Now you can hear me over here instead. Hope that's better. So, yeah, you see it's still... very loud. So as for now, we can just decrease the game audio to like minus 12. Let's try that. I have the controller in my hand. So in order to be sure that I see now it sounds better. But let's go and fast forward to the testing part, you know, when I turn down the volume and we did the testing. So let's see, is it over here? So I can do like test. Test. You see, it's not synced at all. I hope you don't get confused now when it's him talking or not, but you can see here in the audio waves, that's when past Grims is talking. And I think there's a difference in our microphone quality because we are using two different microphones. I'm using the condenser right now, and the past Grims is using the SM57 over at the couch. So let's see if we can do this syncing much better. So I can do like, test, test. Yeah, the game is way too quick, so we're gonna make it, we're gonna push it back a bit.
Can do like, test.
Yeah, a little bit more.
Like, test. Test.
And if you record the game audio separately, now it's, let's see, cursor. So I can do like, test. Test. And if you... I think I mixed it up, actually. It's supposed to be here. So I can do, like, test. Test. Yeah, that's much better. You see, I get confused there. So we just want to make sure that they are so close together as possible. You can see here is the audio for selecting in the game. And this is the audio from my test.
Test.
So you see, it's test. Very much in sync now. And now that's it. You don't need to sync much more than that. Just sync somewhere, usually at the beginning, so you don't forget about it. And then everything should be in sync. So let's just listen and see how it is.
Yeah, fucking spiders! Holy shit, let's go!
We're gonna go through here. And like, yeah, I just... So you see, now that's done. Now you might be thinking, okay, what else is there to do? You have deinterlaced it, we have synced it up, we changed the volume, it sounds good, so can't we just export it now? No, we're not done yet. We can listen a little bit more, and I will tell you what we can do different. With them, and they puke, of course, and then we shoot their dick off if we can. No, we couldn't. He doesn't really care. So you see, kind of looks like a normal cream session. But first off, we need to cut to when we begin. People don't want to listen to you do the testing, right? So I go to where I say, greetings, everybody. That's my cue. So I just go around like, yeah, fuck! I think it's over here, right? Yeah, I just start whenever I feel like it. It doesn't matter when you start. Like, let's do. Greetings! You see, there I say greetings. So let's go ahead and cut this out. So now we only have that part. We're gonna ripple delete and gonna go back to the beginning. So now when it's at 0 seconds, we begin with greetings everybody, my name is Crimson. You see? But now it begins very boom right away. So I usually like to select them and then apply default transition. So now it fades in much more smoother. So let's adjust that a little bit. And let's listen now.
Greetings, everybody. My name
is... See, now it goes in much smoother. It fades in.
My name is Crimson. Welcome back to some old Resident Evil Remake. We have some bloody naked zombies here.
All right. And of course, we need to do the same thing at the end. So let's see. Where do we end it? I don't think I said goodbye in this test, but let's see.
This door, it's rusted shut.
Okay.
So yeah, basically that's how we do it.
So that's where I ended it, kind of. So we just do this. We just cut out that last part. Like this. Take it away. Select it. Apply default. And let's see.
Door, it's rusted shut.
Okay. You see, that might be one part of a session, you know. It's up to you how you divide it. I mean, sometimes I just divide them up. And sometimes I do it like in Undertale, where I say goodbye and hello at every video. But in this one, it's more of a classic Crims session, and it just ends like this.
Okay.
And then the next part of that session begins. I usually like to do it that way, but it's completely up to you how you do it. So, now we have edited where it starts, where it ends, and we have synced everything. What else is there to do? So let's talk about audio editing. We want there to be a good balance between our voice and the video game's audio. And there's different ways to do this. I've used different programs, I've used Cubase to mix my audio, but as of these days, I'm using Adobe Premiere Pro to do the audio editing. It cuts down on the whole process, makes it much more quicker, and I'm gonna show you how I audio edit in Premiere Pro and use different types of effects. So, the first thing we do is to make sure everything is at zero, and we don't change the volume for anything over here. Let's see, is it possible to, we select that volume and have it at zero. So now everything is at its, you know, normal volume, but as we can hear now, it's way out of balance.
No, we couldn't. He doesn't really care.
You see, it's way too much of a difference. So the first thing we do then is to go into the audio mixer, and here we can see both my commentary and the game.
Dig off if you can.
The game audio is very loud, so we can start by, you know, turning that down to about minus 13.
Couldn't. He doesn't really care. Let's go ahead and shoot off his knees instead. Boom!
Yeah, you see, it sounds better. But now let's go into the effects, how we can make it even better. So let's start with the commentary. I do have a preset here already, so I don't need to do the same thing every time. But let's go from this preset and I will show you what every single part does. So I just drag it in here. Boom, here we go. A bunch of effects. Let's turn them off. And the first one is declicker. Now what that does is it takes away a lot of the bass frequencies that are not audible. I mean, or just muffled sounds. Maybe the stomping from upstairs, you know. Let's see. Yes. So that takes away a lot of the very low bass that isn't even included in my voice. So we just take that away so it sounds much more clearer. I usually leave it at 50%. You can have audition and then you can listen to what you take away. You can also use the clicker thing here. This is a deplop that takes away the bass things. And this is the declicker, which takes away some, clicking sounds. But that's not a problem with, you know, recording commentary. So I just leave that off. I just use the deplop. But it is under the declicker effect. So that's that one. Very simple. Leave it at 50%. It's good to go. And then we have a denoiser. It depends on what microphone I use. If I use this one, the condenser, I do want the denoiser because it's so sensitive. So it picks up a lot of noise. This sound, you know, bunch of noise. But with the dynamic microphone, I usually don't use the denoiser. But anyway, you can use it at like -6. Doesn't really matter. But it makes it a little bit more, less noisy. Depending on how good and bad your microphone and recording place is. But I leave it at -6. It works great. It takes away some of that hissing sound, but doesn't make the audio, very bad. If you take like -20, you get like no noise at all. But also it affects the audio quality. It makes it sound like you're under a pillow or something. It makes it, not as clear. So not too much, not too little. Whatever works for you. Play around with it. It all depends on your microphone. The next step for me also depends on the microphone, but I like to increase the bass with about 3 decibels, mostly with that dynamic microphone. The bass isn't very loud, so I increase it by 3 decibels here. Once again, you can either lower it or higher your bass to what you think it sounds great. So it's all up to you, that's just preferences. And then we have an EQ. This one is a little bit more important, I think. this one I have over here at the high bass, or the low mids. I take away 3 decibels at 125 hertz. This might be very advanced for some people, but I make the audio sound better. I don't have a de-esser here in this program, like I did in Cubase. So with all these S sounds, I want them to be not too sharp. I don't want them to attack too much. So I took 6 decibels off at 7,000 hertz. And also I cut out all the very, very high frequencies that aren't even present in human voice, kind of. It's just annoying. It's no point to have it. You won't hear it and it just takes up data. And it's... it sounds better without it, kind of. So it's also a mix around with what you think, take away some of the high frequencies, play around with what you think is best, like put another one here, and I can just like adjust it how I want. I want the mids to go down a bit or maybe increase the mids, you see. Just play around and listen at the same time and see what works. This is after my microphone, of course, and I think this sounds very good. So just play around. It's a lot of playing around with the effects, what works for you. But this one is very universal, the dynamics. Now let's talk about that. Wait a second. So, dynamics are effects like autogate, compressor, expander, and limiter. Very effective tools, actually. So let's go through them one at a time. The first one is an autogate, which means that as soon as the audio is below a certain level, in this case, -50 decibels, the audio gets cut. So we can take away the game audio here and let's listen to the commentary.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and shoot off his knees instead. Boom!
And his friend, you see, as soon as I stop talking, this one goes to red. That's when it's cut. There is no audio whatsoever. And when it's green, that's when it's open. The gate is open. You can hear me. The yellow indicates that it's on its way to get closed. You see here, I have it on 250 milliseconds before it gets closed. If you have it too quick, it sounds very weird. So have it around there. So,
and his friend also wants something, so we're gonna invite him. And there we go. His head blew off. How nice.
Yeah. And what's so good about the gate is that when you don't talk, you don't want all the room noise and maybe people stomping or maybe some, you know, chair noises, like when you, or maybe when you sniff or something. A gate is very good to just, you know, cut out all of that shit that, you know, people don't need to hear. So instead of focusing or having that in the background, just laying there, it's gone and it's just the game audio, and that makes it very clear and much nicer, in my opinion. But don't have it too hard and don't have it too loose. You need to play around and find what where the gate works for you. You don't want, you never, ever want the gate to cut out what you're talking. I mean, you're talking. For example, if I talk, you know, in a lower voice, the gate might not open if you have it set too high. So you need to have the gate so it opens when you, even when you talk pretty, you know, in a low tone. So play around, but be careful so it doesn't take away your talking, because that's the worst thing that can happen. For example, let's go ahead and place it at minus 17 and see what happens.
And his friend also wants something.
You see, we don't hear anything.
Boom! Friend also wants something.
You see, that's a possibility. Now I did an extreme, but you know, be careful, but it's a very good tool. The next one is compressor. And this one is very nice when it comes to commentary, because it levels out the volume difference in your voice. For example, if I talk in this volume and then suddenly I started screaming, the volume difference would be very big. You know, I'm sitting pretty close to a microphone, and if I start to yell, that will be very irritating for people because the volume difference will be so high. But what a compressor does is that when you do, you know, yell or something, it, you know, takes away some volume and makes it so the overall volume stays the same. Now, the same thing here applies to the outer gate. You need to be careful. This can ruin the audio, make it very bad. For example, let's do this at let's do yeah, let's try this one, a typical compressor, and see how it sounds. Let's try without and then let's try with, okay?
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance with them.
And now let's try a compressor.
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance with them.
You see, now the volume was always at a certain level. It was very, you know, go up and down. It was way, it's not good at all. You want to keep it so it takes away when you start to yell. So let's say minus 25 decibel. You see here on the audio that when I talk loudly, let's see how much it takes away.
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance.
You see, when I talk loudly, that's when it kicks in. But not enough, in my opinion. The ratio depicts how much it divides it. So once it goes over minus 25 decibels, it cuts the volume in half. You know, from that point. So I usually go with like 2.5 ratio. And then let's try minus 30 instead and see how much it takes away. Now look at this meter right here.
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance.
You see, that sounds much better, but it's all, you know, preferences, how much you want to be compressed. Because the more you compress, the less dynamic you have in your voice, because your voice is going to be at the same volume all the time. And that takes away some of the life out of it. So not too much. That's why I want to keep the ratio kind of low. So, like, let's, for this part, minus 27 and 2.2. and it shouldn't take more than like minus six.
We have some bloody naked zombies set
around there. That's very good. Yeah. So now when we talk in a normal voice,
of course, and then we shoot their dick off if we can. No, we couldn't. He doesn't really.
So my starting point is usually that it shouldn't take out more than 2 decibels when you talk in a normal volume. That's what you need to find. So when you start to yell, that's when it takes up to like minus 10. So it keeps it at a, you know, good volume. This is also very nice for you as a commentator, because that gives you the freedom to yell how much you even want without being annoying. So compressor is a wonderful tool in the right hands, but can severely damage the life of your commentary. So a lot of experience is needed. Just play around with it, find what sounds best, and then, yeah, you will get it eventually. And then, of course, it takes away volume. So we have a makeup here to, you know, add volume back to the mix. So we go back, because we want to stay above minus 12, around there. Not too close to the ceiling, because then you clip it if you go above. But then there is a very useful tool called limiter. Now this one does that the volume can never ever go above a certain volume. So let's, for example, take it at minus 30. Now look at this meter over here.
Really care. Let's go ahead and shoot off and sneeze instead.
You see, the volume can never go above minus 30. So it's like a compressor, but way more extreme. You should not use it as a compressor. I usually use it as, you know, up here. So the volume can never go above zero. So let's try it.
Boom!
You see here.
And his friend also wants something, so we're gonna invite.
The volume can never go above that that level, and that's great. But you want to be careful so you don't use this makeup too strongly, because this red light lights up once you reach the roof.
Red. Boom!
You don't want to see that red light often at all. So let's try 16. It all depends on how you record it, so it just play around until you find what works.
Easy instead. Boom!
You see, now it didn't blink at all. Let's try 18. I would like to, you know, normally I've tried to find the most loud part for my commentary and then change it from there to see when I reach the roof.
We have some bloody...
You see, now it reaches the roof kind of much. Let's see, 16 instead.
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance.
You see, there we touch the ceiling. So the more it touches the ceiling, the more... you know, compressed it gets, the more, you know, the life gets sucked out, and it just keeps at the max volume, and that's not nice. So let's, you know, for safety's sake, you never need to touch the ceiling, actually, because you have a very big spectrum of audio levels here. So we're just going to keep it at 14, so it rarely reaches the roof.
We have some bloody naked zombies here.
You see, now it doesn't even touch it, but that's okay. It gives the commentary more life, more air. The expander is... I never use it, really. It is kind of an outer gate, but in another way. It's like, as soon as the audio goes above this volume, it cuts the volume. It's kind of... I never really use it. There's no really point. I just use the outer gate, the compressor, and limiter. Yes. So, as I said, play around, see what you think works. The dynamics are a very, very good tool, but can, you know, damage your commentary. So use it if you want to or not. It doesn't really matter. I think it sounds better and more professional with dynamics. So it's all up to you. So that's the effects for the audio. And now we can see here in the audio mixer that when we talk, that we want to be above, we want to be around here, you know.
We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do.
You see, it's very good volume. It's up there. It's not too quiet. It's not too loud. And it can't touch the ceiling and it can't clip. Because if it clips, the audio gets distorted. And that's not good at all. Okay, now let's go into the game audio editing. Now, when it comes to game audio, there is a lot less you need to do, because normally the game audio itself is already, you know, mixed properly. There's not much you need to do other than lower and higher it. But what I usually do with game audio is I have this preset here we can go after. I only use two effects, really. Let's take off that one. So the first one is dynamics again. And so this is an outer gate. Basically, when the game is quiet, the audio gets cut off. This is good because when games like retro games and stuff, when the game audio is, you know, when there's no game audio, you get that noise from the video cables. So what this does is that when the game doesn't, you know, output any sound, this channel gets, you know, cut off. And thereby you don't hear that noise. I mean, that noise from the video cables gets, you know, cut off completely. There is no noise at all. It's just a good thing to have, especially have if you have noisy cables or, you know. But I usually go with this just so when the game is quiet, it is 100% quiet. But with games like recorded on HDMI or like Undertale with Fraps, you don't need that out-of-gate at all because you're not using, you know, those analog cords. You're not using those RCA cords, and thereby there is no noise. And thereby there's no point to use the gate at all because when the game is quiet, it is quiet. So this is mostly for games recorded with analog cables, like the component with RCA, the composite. So this is what I use. It's a very minor difference, but I like it because I'm such a audiophile. I want everything to be perfect. So that's all I use there. Nothing else, just the gate in that. But then I have a multi-band compressor right here. And this is just like a compressor, but on different bands. You know, the bass, the highs, the mids. And what this does is that it levels out the game audio. This is just up to preference if you want to. But let's listen to when the game is loud here, and you can see what I mean. It compresses the different audio spectrums. So listen here. So now the compressor is set to, you know, quite low. So let's do minus 30 just to be extreme, but so you can see what the difference is. You will see the different frequencies getting getting a reduction. So you see, when the zombie is walking or moaning, it only takes away the mids, not the bass. And with a shotgun blast, for example, it uses every single frequency because it's such a loud noise, sound, I mean, which uses everything. So this is just for example, when a game has a very bassy tone, a bassy part. So what will happen is that when that bass goes too high, it will lower everything else. For example, the walking sounds, you know, those high sounds, high frequency sounds, it will lower those as well. And that can sound quite bad in some games. For example, Resident Evil 0 is quite bad with that. This helps so that when there is a bassy part, for example, only that will get, you know, decreased and the other sounds will stay more or less the same. But, you know, for the multiband compressor, I don't use it very strongly. It's only when it's, you know, bad, really bad. So I keep it around minus 15 and only 1.6 ratio for the bass, 2.2 for, you know, the mid sounds. And the reason why I cut out the mid sounds more is because that's where your commentary is. Your commentary is around the mid. So the more you decrease the game's audio in the mid, the clearer your voice will be in relation to it. Your voice doesn't use much bass, especially if you're a female, and your voice doesn't use the high frequencies a lot, you know, with your S sounds. It doesn't use those very much, especially not when you use those equalizers, you know. So having the game have more bass and highs and a little bit lower mids when there's a lot of action going on, it makes your voice pop out much more in the mix. It's a minor difference, but I like it. And that's all. That's basically all I do when it comes to the game audio. Very simple. It's mostly the commentary. So now when both of these have their, you know, their effects, both are synced up, let's go to the very final stage of the whole thing, of the editing, which is, you know, the last audio mixing. So let's just listen and see what works best in relation to these two volume sources.
Do the tango dance with them, and they puke, of course, and then we shoot their dick off if we can. No, we couldn't.
You see, now my voice is very clear compared to the game audio. And it's all up to you. You can have it like this, so the game audio is very loud.
If we can. No, we couldn't. He doesn't really care.
You know, you can do that, or you can go like in between, like -9 decibels, and we can listen to that.
Let's go ahead and shoot off his knees instead. Boom! And his friend also wants something, so we're gonna invite him. And there we go. His head blew off.
You see? It all depends on what you think sounds best. For the most part, you want your voice to be clear. You want people to hear your voice instead of the game. Because that's what they're there for mostly. It's your commentary, not the gameplay. As I've said many times, but play around, see what works for you. And I'm just giving you tips and tricks, basically. So that's it for the video editing. Everything is synced up. Everything is in place. The volume balance is good. It's in sync. You know, everything is as it should be. Now let's go to the final part of the whole thing, which is exporting. Now, exporting is a very, very important part. It doesn't matter if you have the best equipment in the world, if you have done the best commentary ever or done something amazing. It doesn't matter how good this is, because if you mess up the exporting, that will mess up the entire thing or can severely damage it. So let's take a look at the exporting and see how we can make it as good as possible. So we make sure that everything is as it should be here in this place. Now we go into File, Export Media, or Control M. Now we get this screen right here. We're gonna increase that so it's easier to see. First off, we're gonna choose the format. We want it to be compressed because it's going to be too big of a file to make it uncompressed, and it's going to take too long to upload to YouTube and take too much space on your hard drive. So we're gonna go with the compressed format, H.264 MP4, but we're gonna have good quality with it. So we have that format, and we have presets here as well, so just choose if you have one after you're done here. But we're gonna do it from scratch. Now, as I said before, it depends on what game you have recorded and everything, but in this example we went with the Resident Evil Remake, which is a 4x3 non-widescreen, as you can see here, and it is in 30 FPS or 29.97. So, we're gonna make sure everything as it should be. This one should be 720 because we upscale it. So now we have no black borders, because if you get it wrong, you get black borders. You don't want that. So the correct resolution for this one is 720. So that's right. The frame rate, very crucial that you get this right. This one is 29.97. As we can see here, it is the same. We exported the same thing. Aspect should be square pixels always, I think. And then TV standard doesn't really matter, but just use NTSC, especially now that we recorded this with 60 Hz. Maybe you can use PAL if you're recording in 50 Hz. It doesn't really matter, I think. Profile constrains the bit rate range and controls other properties such as compression algorithm and chroma format. So the higher you have here, the better. But this one is more compatible. But we live in 2016 now, soon to be 2017. So we can use the best type of MP4 profile. So use high, I highly recommend it, pun not intended. And then we have a level for it. This also depends on the game. Since this is a 30 FPS at 720, we can keep it around 4, like 4.1, doesn't really matter. But if it is a 1080 at 60, you want it to be, 5.1, really. But for this example, let's go with 4.1. When you click on that, it usually changes this to, what that quality is. So we need to change it back, make sure that everything is as it should be, like that. Progressive, yes. Square pixels, high profile, 4.1. You might as well check this box, render at maximum depth. We get better colors. It doesn't take much more time, even though it does say that it takes more time. I had never noticed, it just results in better quality. Now, here we go. This depends on how fast your CPU is and how much patience you have. This is how it encodes it. I always go with variable bitrate, 2 pass. That means that it encodes the entire project 2 times to get the best possible quality for the lowest space. Now we want, then we have the target bitrate. You know, we can see down here estimated file size for this 34-second long video. If we have it like up here, it's a very big file for such a short video, and that's pretty overkill, especially for a 720 at 30. It all depends on the resolution and the frame rate and how much action goes on in the game. In this game, the camera stands still a lot, you see that? So that means that the encoder doesn't need much more data to, you know, render these frames many times, because it doesn't move so much, only these move. So this game doesn't take much data, but the game like Overwatch, where there is a lot of movements everywhere, then you need more bitrate. There are guides on the internet how to get the right bitrate, but for this example, 720 at 30 frames, you can safely go with like 5 megabits per second, and then I usually have the maximum bitrate at the double that size, but the target bitrate should be 5 megabits per second. And that results in a very good file size, 21 megabytes for a 34-second video, and it is in very good quality. But, you know, I usually go with even more than that. I have a big hard drive and I have fiber optic internet, so I usually go with like 10 megabit per second for these types of videos, just to be sure that there aren't any, you know, artifacts, any, you know, pixelated mess. You want it to be good crystal clear quality. Or maybe you don't. Maybe you don't care. So it all depends on what you think is needed. But I usually go with this, upload it to YouTube, and then I download that video from YouTube just to have it as a backup. But the video that YouTube got from me was in a very high quality, and that results in better viewing experience and quality for the others. Then we have keyframe distance. It basically is how many frames is between you know, the keyframes. In a game like this, where there aren't many movements, you should definitely use the keyframe distance and have it like 3 times the frame rate. So 90 frames, every 90 frames there will be a keyframe. You can Google that if you want to know more about keyframes, but it will result in better quality at lower file size. But if it's a game like Overwatch, where there's a lot of movements, you don't want to use it, maybe. Just click it off and the program will do it, you know, optimally, I think. You can also go with like this if you want to. It will result in good quality either way. So let's just go with none. But just this game is very good with it, so we're going to enable it. And then we have maximum render quality. It like doubles the rendering time without giving a big difference, so I don't use it. It takes too long of a time to render it, especially when it's like a 2-hour session. So I don't use it, and the quality difference isn't that big. We're not going to use previews, and we're not going to use frame blending. We don't want that. We want every frame to be its own picture, you know, its own thing. And then we go into audio. We're going to use AAC, Advanced Audio Codec, the same sample rate. We want it to be stereo, because that's what we recorded the game in. And then high quality audio, sure, why not? And then we have the bitrate. This is how much space the audio takes. The lower, the worse quality, the higher, the, you know, the better quality, but bigger file size. Everything above 128 is, you know, green. You should never go under 128. It will result in bad audio quality and artifacts, and, you know, it's not good. I usually go with the maximum and upload it to YouTube and then download that. But if you are planning to save this on your computer, I would recommend 160. You could never go wrong with 160 or even 192. You will never, ever go wrong with that. But for uploading to YouTube's sake, I usually go with, you know, the max, just because I'm not going to save this file on my desktop, on my computer. I'm going to upload it to YouTube and then delete it. So this extra space is nothing I need to worry about. So that's what I go with. Multiplexer, make sure it is on MP4, and then standard. It's not supposed to be stream quality. It is compatibility. This is for YouTube, so we want it to be standard and MP4. Make sure there are no filters like Gaussian blur. It just makes it, you know, there's no point at all. Maybe there is a use for it at low if you have a very pixelated video. I don't know. Depends on what you think looks good. I mean, here we have a difference, you see. it makes it more soft. It's all up to you. But these are the important settings. Make sure it is the same as, you know, the recorded footage. And then we have the audio here, 48k hertz. Yeah, good stuff. Make sure it is the entire sequence, you know, this entire thing here. You encode everything. And then we can save a preset if we want to. And then we can just click on either export immediately, or we can queue it to Adobe Media Encoder, and that's what I always do. So we're going to do that. This opens up a Media Encoder. So we click here on Output File. We want this to be, you know, somewhere. Let's just test whatever you want. Desktop test. And then, yeah, preset custom, or even, you know, that one which you choose. You can even choose it here if you want to. And then we just click Start Encoding. So now we can see down here, my computer is pretty damn fast, so it will encode this pretty fastly. We see the quality here, we see the aspect ratio with the, you know, it's 4x3. We see where it will go, everything, how long it will take and all that. So that is it. That's how you edit. That's the whole editing process. So now when this is done, let's go ahead and take a look at it and you will see how it turned out. Greetings everybody, my name is Crimson, and welcome back to some more Resident Evil Remake. We have some bloody naked zombies here. There's only one thing we need to do. Do the tango dance with them. And they puke, of course, and then we shoot their dick off if we can. No, we couldn't. He doesn't really care. Let's go ahead and shoot off his knees instead. Boom! And his friend also wants something, so we're gonna invite him. And there we go. His head blew off. Oh, nice. Let's continue. This door, it's rusted shut. Okay. So now we arrive at the end of the video. I know we didn't talk about the different styles so much. We mainly focused on how to record different platforms. But let's take an example of how different commentary styles can work. Look at the Angry Video Game Nerd. Now that's James Rolfe. He created the AVGN, Angry Video Game Nerd. So that's a character that he plays, but the person behind it is James Rolfe. The same thing happens with me, with Crims. So in real life, I am Alex. I'm Alex right now. But when I do commentary, I go into this little persona called Crims, who is more impulsive, aggressive, and, you know, more mean. But all I can say is just be yourself and have fun. Because if you're having fun, then the audience is going to notice that as well. Yeah, so I hope you learned something today. Hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any questions or any feedback of any sort, please leave them in the comments below. I appreciate it very much. Yeah, thank you very much for watching and good luck out there.